Hello again, everyone, and welcome to my next video. This part 8 will be the final installment in the series in which I have been analyzing Rabbi Gestetner's response to the false speaker Y.Y. Jacobson and corrupt rabbinic judge Avi Kahan, who put out the Kolive video falsifying halacha in matters of Jewish divorce. For those of you who are here for the first time, I will link for you below the previous 7 parts of this series so that you will have the entire picture. Seen together, it contains Rabbi Gestetner's full refutation of these rabbis' false interpretations of halacha in matters of Jewish divorce. So let us get right into it now with statement number 19. At approximately the 1 hour and 42 minute mark, Jacobson makes his closing remarks against those who he calls get abusers, referring to them as dead men walking. Let us hear it now in his own words.
Closing words would be turning to all the get abusers and all people who are preventing their spouses from moving on. You may have all the excuses in the world, all the rationalizations in the world. I think you should realize, to quote the Rebbe in one of the letters I said earlier, that by chaining your spouse and keeping her chained, even with all the excuses and rationalizations in the world, you're ultimately not just oppressing her. You're much more oppressing yourself. When we torture other people, we lose our soul. We die inside. I sometimes look into the eyes of these types of people. These are dead men walking. You have no life. You have no soul anymore. And my heart goes out for you, because when you kill other people, you die first. When you torture other people, you lose your connection to yourself, to truth, to God, to Torah, to anything real, to anything authentic. You become like a shell. You're literally like a shell. Have rachmanis not only on your spouse, also have rachmanis on yourself. And I see sometimes the situations of a guy who's not giving a get to his wife. He has 8 kids. All the 8 children stopped speaking to him. He was disinvited from a bris of his own anicle where he was supposed to be a sandik. I said, look, you've lost everything. Lost everything just to take revenge from your wife with all your excuses that you want shalom bayis. And this is
Rabbi Gestetner's response to this is that it is a very serious prohibition to slander innocent men who are suffering greatly due to their wives' actions, even though they have done nothing wrong according to halacha. Instead of looking out for the true victims, the men who got caught in the crosshairs of the feminist court system, Jacobson justifies it when others take wrongful action against these innocent men, such as when they prevent them from taking part in Jewish ceremonies. He could have used his Kolai video to attack these heinous practices, but instead he chose to do just the opposite, defending the actions that the women and their enablers take against these innocent men. By promoting the sin of shaming men in public, he's only creating more sins of Eishes Ish and Mamzerus. Therefore, it is actually Jacobson himself who is the dead man walking, because he is now committing spiritual suicide through his negative words and malignant influence. And Chazal in Brachas, Daf 18b, have stated that Rishoyim, Bechayeim, Kruin, Mesim, that evil people are considered dead even while they are still alive. And now we have reached statement number 20, the final statement that Rabbi Gestetner analyzes in the Kolai video. At approximately the 1 hour and 43 minute mark, Jacobson begins to tell us a story about the Chafetz Chaim, who was advising a man who had a dispute with another man. But then, all of a sudden, he pivots to start talking about my divorce case again. I could not make this up if I wanted to. Let us listen now to Jacobson, who's so obsessed with yours truly that he just cannot stop himself.
The story I want to leave you with is a story from the Chafetz Chaim. The Chafetz Chaim in Radin, Rabbi Yisrael Meir HaKoyen Kagan, Zeichet Tzadik Levracha, once called in a Jew in Radin who was a huge Baal Machloikas. He had a huge Machloikas, a fight with somebody, and it was bitter, and it was divisive, and it became personal, and it became really, really disgusting. This person, who was needing his machlokes against another person, one of his children fell very ill. Chafetz Chaim called him in and said, listen, I don't know God's cheshbonos, but I certainly know that machlokes by Jews creates horrible negative energy. And I'm worried that perhaps this child is suffering from the negative energy that came into your home as a result of the machlokes. Stop for the sake of your boy. Stop it. Make peace. Now listen what this man told the Chafetz Chaim. It's very sad. He said, Alle meine Kinder sollen sterben, aber ich will gewinnen. Let all his kids perish, but he's going to win the war. Now I want to tell you something. This is what Natschanes does to people. This is what the need for victory does to people. This is what trauma does to people. This is what mental illness does to people. This is what stubbornness does to people. You destroy that which you love most. You think he didn't love his children? I'm sure he loved his children. But the need to win, I'm so obsessive. It destroys my life, my schedule, my mental space. Like Rabbi Kahn said before, there's a guy, 18 years he didn't give a get, and he's still texting me and emailing me that I'm being over on Lashon Hara. I'm being over on Lashon Hara when I speak about this. He remarried. He remarried a second woman. Doesn't give a get to his wife. He's telling me that I'm over on Lashon Hara. And you see, poor people, give a get. Move on. Free yourself. Most importantly, remember, there's a Torah. There's emes. Do what Hashem wants. Even if your moods and your instincts are screaming, revenge, revenge, I'm right, I'm idealistic. She's the worst person in the world. Like the Rebbe said, the Eibishter is starker. God is stronger. Who will not deceive Hashem. We are Jews who follow a Torah, even when my emotions don't agree with it. Your emotions may not agree with it, that's fine. Do the right thing. Free her, and in the process, you free yourself. And then you'll be able to look in the mirror and see yourself and see a real person, a living person, not a dead man.
Rabbi Gestetner's response to this is that first of all, he has already covered the fine points of my case in statement number 13, which you can find in part 6 of this series. He then goes on to say that I was 100% correct in accusing Jacobson of speaking Lashon Hara against me. This is due to the fact that I've been following halacha all along by listening to whatever my Bezdin told me to do, and whoever says otherwise is speaking slander. So instead of Jacobson preaching to others about how to behave, he should take a good look in the mirror, because that is where he will find the real Baal Machlokes that the Chafetz Chaim was talking about, a creator of strife and discord, because he willfully dispenses wrong facts about my case, thereby creating anger and division in Klal Yisrael. But even more astonishing than the fact that I am being harassed by Jacobson, even though I am following the correct halachic protocol by listening to my Bezdin, is the fact that he is intentionally concealing the truth about Rabbi Gestetner's letter to Lana Ralbag, dated September 5, 2018, which you could find linked below. In that letter, Rabbi Gestetner outlines to Lana certain things that she must do in order to receive a kosher get. But alas, some of these items are directly connected to the fake rabbis of the RCC, namely Gershon Bess, Nochum Sauer, and Avram Union, who are refusing to follow the steps that are necessary in leading to a kosher get. And these rabbis clearly have an agenda. So it is anyone's guess if they will ever summon the fortitude to do the right thing to help this woman. So let me quote for you now the things that Rabbi Gestetner asked of Lana Ralbakin in that letter. Number 1. All seruvim put out against me are to be voided unconditionally. I have been compliant all along with halacha and was simply following the Bezdin's directives, which I have every right to do. Therefore, all the seruvim against me fall under the category of Moitzi Shemra and are unjustified. Number 2. She must see to it that I am allowed into all shuls unconditionally with all the associated privileges that go along with that. And number 3. any and all forms of public shaming against me, whether it be via print publications, internet videos, letters, blogs, or social media, must be removed unconditionally prior to negotiating the delivery of her get. Rabbi Gestetner explains that the above three requests were not made in the spirit of competition or spite, but rather were made only in consideration of Jewish law. That is because in order to receive a kosher get, there cannot be a situation where there is any coercion whatsoever. And coercion is exactly what this suite of sanctions currently being imposed upon me are considered, and they invalidate the get. Rabbi Gestetner now asks, how much longer are the parties involved going to continue with their inane attempts to coerce me into giving a get? Their tactics have been tried for 17 years now, but have produced zero results. What they seem to fail to understand is that the passage of time will never change the halacha. Whether it be only 1 year or 30, the halacha still remains the same. A get cannot be delivered under a state of coercion. The tragedy here is that these rabbis have a simple solution to free a woman of her chains, but due to them being too invested in their own honor, they refuse to acknowledge their mistakes. But all they need to do is remove their illegal siruvim and allow me back into shul with all the associated privileges. But instead of doing this simple thing, they would rather continue to label me an abuser and get refuser, and so they keep Lana spinning her wheels like a car stuck in the snow. So to summarize, the mistake of people like Y.Y. Jacobson, Avi Kahan, Gershon Bess, Avram Union, Nochem Sauer, Aryeh Ralbag, and Herschel Schechter is that A. I already deposited a get for Lana. B. I am following the dictates of Halacha as directed by my Beis Din. And C. I refuse to deliver an unkosher get. And the reason that it will be not kosher is because coercive tactics continue to be administered against me. So contrary to what these fake rabbis think, the passage of time does not make someone a bigger get refuser, but it certainly does make Lana Ralbag and the aforementioned rabbis bigger liars, bigger abusers of halacha, and bigger accumulators of sin. Because the longer this legacy of lies and defamation goes on, the bigger will be the stack of sins which accumulates around them, of which they will be held accountable in the afterlife. So when Jacobson states that get withholders do what they do in order to be victorious over their wives, his words more accurately pertain to the phony rabbis involved in my case. They are the ones who seek to be victorious in this divorce case and in all other divorce cases. They are the ones who seek to win the war. All they have to do to get the ball rolling in my case is to adhere to these three simple steps outlined in Rabbi Gestetner's letter. It is the only way to allow for the beginning of the halachic process of negotiating the delivery of a get. Anyone who does not understand this requirement is lacking fluency in the fundamental principles of the din of get meusa. They should not be involved in the laws of Jewish divorce because they would be committing malpractice. Because refusing to follow even these three simple steps is equivalent to shutting the door on the process of obtaining a kosher get. And Jacobson needs to listen to his own words about following the halacha and not his own feelings, which in his case have their origins in the feminist viewpoint that is found in the marketplace. The Gemara in Bava Kamma, Daf 52a, states that when a shepherd is angry with his flock of sheep, he appoints a blind goat to lead them, and in this way they will wind up in fields of thorns or falling into pits. So it is when Hashem is not pleased with our ways, as is the case in our generation, that he sends us misguided and evil leaders who lead us astray. Woe to a generation that is being led by such a group of blind and ignorant people. Our rabbis have stated that in the past, the evil inclination had a difficult job to do because it had to go and entice people to sin one by one. But then it had a better idea and instead just got one person to put out a pamphlet full of heresy. In this way, he was able to get thousands upon thousands of people to sin very easily. This is exactly what happened during the Enlightenment. And in our generation, we have people like Jacobson and Kahan who are preaching to the thousands of people over the internet to do forced gets. This will lead to millions of sins of Ashes Ish and countless Mamzerim who will come protesting to them in the afterlife. What a pity that a person like Jacobson, who had so much going for him based upon his previous work, is now throwing it all away for nothing. Rabbi Gestetner now concludes his letter by stating that this entire 8-part analysis of the Kolai video is coming to lament the sad situation we have today, where corrupt rabbis are distorting the Torah, the halacha, and the truth, which is that a get must always be given through husband's own desire and free will. Their heretical agenda is taken from the views of the common folk in the marketplace, and their only goal is the promotion of feminism in contrast to the Torah concept of the man having the prerogative to initiate divorce. The consequences of their actions are the sins of Ashes Ish and Moitzi Shemra. The Chidushi Harim in Parshas HaShlach in his Sefer HaZchus asks, how are we supposed to understand the episode of the Meraglim, the spies that Moshe Rabbeinu sent to investigate the land of Israel? The Torah states that 1 minute before they set out on their mission, the spies were righteous and upstanding leaders, and the next minute they were sinners. Additionally, he asks, why did Hashem consider it a major sin when the Bnei Yisrael cried after hearing the report from the Meraglim who declared that the land was not good? After all, it was 10 spies against 2. And don't we know that the halacha dictates that we follow the majority of sages? The Chidush HaRim answers that we only follow the majority when we don't already know the halacha. But when the Torah law is obvious to all, we don't follow a majority of rabbis who tell us otherwise. In the case of the Meraglim, it should have been obvious to all that the land that Hashem promised us was very good, since he already told the Bnei Yisrael that the land of Canaan was their destination. And he also assured them that they have nothing to fear. Therefore, what the majority of rabbis said should have been disregarded. The Chidush HaRim concludes by telling us not to be surprised in the end of days when we see that our leaders will try to lead us once again astray, just as the Meraglim tried to do, saying that what is forbidden is permitted and what is permitted is forbidden. Hashem decreed that it should happen this way because he expects every Jew to then find within himself a spark of dedication to the emes, to follow the simple truth of the Torah. So this is the test of our generation. Will we be able to summon our inner strength and stand up to our fake leaders who attempt to try and steer us away from the authentic path of Torah and mitzvahs by promoting new concepts that go against our Torah traditions? In our case, it is about the fact that we already know the established halacha. A get is not allowed to be forced, so we do not care if a majority of rabbis say otherwise, because they are speaking falsehoods. My wish for all of us is that Hashem should grant us the fortitude, insight, and wisdom to withstand this test of our times and bring us soon the Mashiach that we so desperately need. Thank you for watching, and see you all in the next video.